Let's look at this numerical associated with decreasing term life assurance policy, wherein I am interested in computing the premium as well as the reserves. So here look at this. A life insurance company issues a 10-year decreasing term, right? The term of the policy is 10 year and it is a decreasing term life. Aged 50, male and 50. Death benefit is 100,000 in the first year, 90,000 in the second, and decreases by 10,000 each year, so that the benefit in the 10th year is 10,000. The death benefit is payable at the end of the year of death. So I can very well find out the present values, expected present value of the death benefit. What is the expected present value of the death benefit? Probably 10,000 at the end of the first year, 90,000 at the end of second year, and so on. So probably I could have very well written it as 110,000 minus 10,000, probably for the first year. I'll write it as 110,000 minus 20,000. So this looks like on one side there is an increasing kind of an annuity, and on the other side there is a regular one. So this I will very much write it as 110,000 A 5010. And because it is select, I call it as A select 5010. And minus 10,000 and all, I'll write it as 10,000 times IA 50 colon 10. So the present value, the expected present value of the death benefit very clearly comes out as 110,000 A 50 colon 10. For a term life, minus 10,000 IA 50, again this is a select life, 50 colon 10 for a term life. So the first part, if I really want A 50 colon 10, I require the values of A 50, I require A 60, I also require 10P 50, means I require L 60 as well as L 50. From here I'll get 10P 50, and at the same time I also require V power 10. So all these are giving me the first term. And for the second term, I require IA 50. I also require IA 60. And V power 10 and all that stuff is fine. So which will help me in computing the second term. So from here, I can find the expected present value of the death benefit in total for this policy. So for that I am referring to AM92 select tables at 6% rate of interest. So let's look out for those tables, and basically based on that let's try to put some numbers. A50, the first thing which I really need to update is A50, which comes out to 0.20463. Alright, then A60, 0.32692. Alright, then I'll also take IA50 and IA60 from here. IA50, 4.84789. And IA60 works out to 5.46572. Right? Then I also require a few information relating to L's. So I'll take L60 9287.2164, L select 50 9706.0977. So 10P50 is giving me L60 by L50. This is giving me 10P50. V per 10 gives me 1 by 1.06 to the power 10. This is V per 10. So from here, I can very well find out the first term, which is 110,000 times A50 10 comes out as A50 minus 10P50 times V power 10 times A60, which gives me that this is the first term of the benefit. Then the second term, which is talking about the decreasing part, is 10,000 times IA50 minus 10P50 times V power 10 times IA60 plus 10 times A60. So this is what is the second term. So overall, I can look at the expected present value right under this 6000 scenario. The expected present value of the death benefit overall is what is working out as the first term minus the second term. So expected present value of the death benefit is coming out to 1486.82. Alright, so that is the first part. Level premiums are payable annually in advance for the term of the policy. So this becomes P times A double dot 50:10. So this becomes the annual premiums, expected present value of the annual premium. So expected present value of the premiums, I can directly talk about as P times A double dot 50:10. So for that, again, I require A double dot 50. And I also require A double dot 60 as well. So A double dot 50 at the rate of 6% interest, I'll get A double dot of 50 as 14.044, and A double dot, this is for select. So A double dot select 50, I'll take it as 14.051, whereas A double dot 60 for a normal life, I'll take it as 11.891. So from here, I can talk about the expected present value of the premiums being A double dot 50 minus V power 10 times 10P50 times A double dot 60. So 7.69 something. So that much times P is the expected present value of the premium. So I am having that number as well. Then I am also looking at the remaining stuff. Now I have to look out for the expected present value of the different kinds of expenses. Initial expenses for me are 200, and one more initial expense is 25% of the total annual premium. So it directly becomes 25%, that's it, of the annual premium, which is P. So that's one more number that is coming up. Then similarly, renewal expenses, 2% of each premium from the start of the second policy year. 2% of each policy premium, okay, renewal expense 1 comes out as 2% of 2% of the total annual, 2% of the each premium from the start of the second. So I'll take this as the present value minus 1, because the first year's number is not included. So this much of P goes as a part of my renewal expense 1. 50% and 50 per annum, inflating at 1.923% per annum at the start of the second. So which means the renewal expense is going to be 50 per annum, and it is getting inflated at the rate of 1.923%. So it becomes 50 times 1.01923, right, times V. So it's as good as I'm computing this new I, which is at the rate of 1.01923 divided by 1.06. If I look at this, right, probably if I look at 1.01923 divided by 1.06, if I look at, and if I take the 1 by of it, it's almost 4%. So it's as good as I could have taken the 50 at the rate of 4%. Right, from the second year onwards, I could very well take 50 at the rate of 4%. Right, I could very much, so the renewal expense 2 is nothing but 50 times, now I have to look at for 4% piece. So I'll take it as 50, which I'm incurring each of the periods, right from the next year onwards. I am looking at the end of the period, 50 for a 9-year period, because I'm looking at it just for 9 years. I'm not including the 10th year into the same. So it's as good as 50 at the end of each of the years. I'll write it as 50:9. The same thing I could write it as 50 a double dot, because one period later. So we can very well talk about a x colon n is same as a double dot x colon n plus 1. So the same thing I'll use, a double dot 50:10. So this would be the renewal expense, but at the 4% kind of stuff, which means here I require a double dot 50 at the rate of 4%. I require a double dot 60 at the rate of 4%. V power 10 at the rate of 4%. And 10p50 I can still use. So at the rate of 4%, now if I am looking at a double dot 50, it is 17.454, a double dot 60, 14.134, and V power 10 is 1 by 1.04 to the power 10. So based on these, I can very well find out the RE2, which will come out as 50 times A double dot 50 10, which is nothing but A double dot 50 minus V power 10 times 10P 50 times A double dot 60. So this is what is coming out to the this is what is coming to renewal expenses for the period 2. Similarly, claim expenses also, I am talking about 200 inflating at 1.923. Wherever I am seeing 1.923, it's better that I directly bring out it as 50:10, the death benefit, but this is at 4%. So I require A50 as well as A60 again, but this at the rate of 4%, not the original ones. V per 10 we already have. So I'll pull out capital A50 and A60 also. Capital A50 select 0.32868. And A60 is working out to 0.4564. So from here, again I can get the claim expense. The claim expense is working out to 200 times A50. A50 is this much minus V power 10 times 10P 50 times A60. So present value of the claim expense is going to be somewhere around this. So these are the various costs that are involved. Right, overall I could see that 7.68P, 14.68 is the death benefit. Expected present value of the death benefit. And now in case of expenses, if I am looking at, one is this, then we have the renewal expense 2 and the claim expense, which is working out to somewhere around 622. And probably here I have to do a minus 1 as well. So this is where I'll look at the renewal expense 2. I can subtract the 50 from it. So from here, this is working out to the expected present value of the different expenses. There are two parts. One is the constant part, which I take as 200. Plus the renewal expense 2 plus the claim expense, which is 572. And we are also talking about the P terms, which is 0.25P, 0.13P. These are the two P terms. So this is P. So this is where now I can talk about the premium. From here, I can very comfortably compute the premium, which comes out as the expected present value of the death benefit, expected present value of the expenses, divided by the expected present value of the premiums minus the expenses which are expressed in premium term. Overall, it works out that the premium for this kind of a situation is somewhere around 281 pounds. So this is an appropriate premium for this kind of a numerical. Fair enough. Now I am also parallelly asked, calculate the gross premium reserve at the end of the 9th year using the same premium basis. So I have to find out the gross premium reserve. For that, I am, if I am going on a prospective reserve kind of a basis, I have to look at the expected present value, expected present value of the premiums, or expected present values of the death benefits, minus or plus the expected present value of the expenses. So expected present value of the death benefit, I have to add up the expected present value of expenses, and I have to subtract the expected present value of the premiums to be paid. Now, if I look at the expected present value of the death benefit here, it is only 10,000 to be paid. So I could have directly got it as 10,000 divided by 1.06. That's it. The expected present value of the death benefit is coming out to this much. Straightforward. Now, again, coming to the expenses, initial expenses, nothing is incurred. So the only thing is the renewal expense, right? Renewal expense is coming out to 0.013 times the P. Okay, and probably if I'm looking at the claim related expense, right, even the renewal expense, even this is something which I have to look at. 50 is yet to be paid, or probably 50 times, right, one expense if I look at 50 times 1.01923 to the power 9 requires to be paid. So that is an expense that is left to be paid. So this is the expense which I can directly talk of. And similarly, I am also talking in terms of claims. Claim expense is also inflated, which will be 200 times 1.01923 to the power 9. Right, 1.01923 to the power 9. This is going to be at the end, which means I have to discount it by 1.04. So this is going to be the expected present value of the expenses. And premiums wise, I take out this 2%, so it becomes 98% itself directly. I'll take out the renewal expense 1 from it, so I'll take it as 98% of the premium is being received at the beginning of the year itself, which is coming out to this much. So overall, I could directly see that the gross premium reserve in our case is very much working out. The gross premium reserve is very much working out to this 10,000, whatever is the 10,000, the present value, I have to really multiply this with the probability of death. So the probability of death comes from Q59 for the same period. So I will look out for Q59, which is 0.007140. This is relating to the death benefit. Similarly, whatever is the claim benefit that has come out also, that is also associated with the death. So even this, I'll multiply it with 0.00714. The regular expenses, they are incurred even if the death is not involved, and minus the expected present value of the premium, overall resulting in some 100 minus 147, which is looking like the gross premium reserve is negative. So the expected future income is higher than the expected future outgo. Because in the past, the outgo was much, much higher than the income. So there was a higher amount of reserves that were maintained, and as the policy is nearing to the lapsing or the maturity part, we are seeing that the income is much higher than the outgo, which has resulted in the overall the reserves being negative. So in a decreasing term assurance kind of a policy, we would typically observe this kind of behavior in the data.